All right, so we should start. Probably, I'm happy to have Irina here and introduce her briefly. We've been working together since about a decade, I guess, quite productively, I think. So I know her well. So let me admit somebody else. Irina is an associate professor of psychology at the University of Padua in Italy, and then her research interests include neurodevelopmental disorders such as nonverbal learning disability, autism spectrum disorder, and specific learning disorders, specifically related to mathematics difficulties in children primarily. And she's the co-founder and deputy director of a university clinical center for neurodevelopmental disorders in Padua. And she's also the coordinator of an international master's degree course in Padua on developmental and educational psychology. Right. So that's a brief introduction to her. And then please, I give her the stage, the virtual stage in the matrix where we all reside now. You could share your
Yes.
screen and just we are curious.
Thank you, Daniel, for this presentation, and good afternoon, everybody. I'm really glad to be here and to be invited to this seminar series here in Cambridge. And first, I'd like to thank Danish for inviting me. So even though this seminar is online rather than in person, I hope you may still find this interesting. And today I will talk about the developmental and visuospatial disorder, which is better known as nonverbal learning disability. And this is a relatively unknown neurodevelopmental disorder and is characterized by visuospatial difficulties. So before starting my presentation, let's see a brief overview of my talk. Okay, there is, okay. I will start with an historical presentation of the nonverbal learning disability. And hereafter, please consider that I may use the term NLD, so the abbreviation, instead of the full term nonverbal learning disability. So after the history of the disorder, I will present some more recent studies useful to understanding the cognitive functioning of these children. And specifically, we will take into account their neuropsychological and academic functioning. And also the consequences of visuospatial difficulties in their social and relational functioning. And finally, I will present you a brief overview of some recent evidence coming from neuroimaging studies, which together with the other findings have led us to conclude that NLD can be considered as a distinct neurodevelopmental disorder. So let's start then with the history of nonverbal learning disability. And the history of this disorder is almost new when compared to other neurodevelopmental disorders. NLD as a concept dates back to the end of the 1960s when Johnson and Mangelbusch, you can see the pictures here, in their insightful work described for the first time the nonverbal disorder of learning. And according to these authors, children with nonverbal learning disability had difficulties in nonverbal aspects of their environment, but they had an average verbal intelligence. So they described four main impaired learning domains, which are listed here in this slide, and they included the perception, in other words, so perception difficulties, of course. So these children have difficulties to process and to learn through pictures. And the second impaired domain, according to this author, was the processing of gestures. And by this, we mean the ability to learn motor patterns, such as those required in using simple objects. Then body image, in other words, one's perceptions of one's own body. And finally, spatial orientation. So after the seminal work of Johnson and Michelbust, until the beginning of our current century, the history of research on verbal learning disability was largely influenced by the studies carried out by Baron Rourke. So Rourke developed a model called the White Matter Model, and he listed the impairments of these children into three main areas, which are the neuropsychological area, the academic area, and the social emotional one. So we won't be exploring this model in detail today, but you can see here in this slide a brief outline of this model. So what's important to know is that the white matter model of Rourke's assumed that the deficits observed in non-verbal learning disability results from an impaired myelination of the fiber tracts in the right hemisphere. So, however, in his later studies, Rourke used nonverbal syndrome as an umbrella term that could also include a heterogeneous group of more specific neurological disorders, such as the genesis of the corpus callosum, for example, or genetic syndromes, for example, Turner syndrome and Williams syndrome. And for these reasons, mainly for this reason, the Rourke's model has been criticized within the scientific community. So despite the previously mentioned impasse, following the critics' move to Rourke's model, a remarkable effort has been made in recent years to better understand the profile of these children in terms of neuropsychological, academic, and social functioning. So in the next slides, we will take into account all of these aspects, starting from neuropsychological functioning. And the first study I'd like to summarize here was published in 2010 by Margaret Semrut-Klickman and her co-authors in 2010, as I told you before. They carried out a cross-disorder comparison study involving a total of 345 children with different neurodevelopmental disorders. And specifically, they compared children with nonverbal learning disability, children with autism spectrum disorder, which are called here Asperger syndrome, and children with ADHD, divided into combined and inattentive types. The main aim of this study was to analyze possible differences amongst these groups on measure of fluid reasoning, visual motor skills, perceptual abilities, and so on. So I've summarized here in this slide the results. And in this table, I've highlighted the key differences between children with nonverbal learning disability and other neurodevelopmental disorders. So first, the children with NLD obtained lower scores than the other groups in performance IQ. which is a measure of visual spatial intelligence. And they showed a difference between verbal and visual spatial intelligence, which is called the ERVP split. In addition, they showed lower scores than the other groups in the judgment of line orientation, JLO, which is a measure of perception skills. They performed poorly than the other groups in the grooved pegboard test, which is a measure of manual dexterity. And finally, children with nonverbal learning disability showed the lowest scores compared with the other groups in the Ray complex figure task, which is a measure of visual constructive skills. So the Ray complex figure test, which is represented here, requires the child to copy a complex image as accurately as possible, and then to recall and draw the same figure after a few minutes. And as I told you before, it's a measure of visual constructive skills, but it involves many other cognitive processes, such as perceptual organization, visual spatial skills, as well as fine motor abilities and visual spatial memory. And in my opinion, this is one of the most sensitive tests for diagnosing children with nonverbal learning disability. And here in this example, you can see how this 10-year-old child with a diagnosis of nonverbal learning disability, Samuele, copied and recalled the image. So even if the image was shown as it appears here above, this child drew the image rotated in the space. And as you can see, all the details inside of the image were not located as they appeared in the original one. So it's taken for granted maybe that the performance of this child in this task is below average for his age. And this is another example of an 8-year-old child with NLD, Lorenzo, and he starts drawing the image with the color green, followed by blue or gray, black and yellow. And as you can see, he didn't draw the rectangle with the diagonals, but instead he added the details of the complex figure. And in the recall phase, maybe followed the same strategy, but he lost most of the details. In particular, he didn't remember the relationship between them. So coming back to research studies, this is a study published in 2014 in which we compare children with NLD, children with dyslexia, and those with typical development in visual spatial working memory tasks. And specifically, we examined the forward and backward recall of locations, of colors, as well as the binding of locations and colors. And we found that children with NLD had particular difficulties in the backward recall of locations. Thus, this spatial working memory seems to be another impaired process in children with nonverbal learning disability. And in this further research, we compared children with nonverbal learning disability, children with autism spectrum disorder without intellectual disability, and children with typical development and visual spatial processing skills. And importantly, our groups were not statistically different on visual spatial intelligence. So I'd like to explain you now the paradigm we used in this research. And in particular, this paradigm has been mainly used in children with autism spectrum disorders. And Previous studies on these children, so children with autism, revealed that a so-called local bias in the way they process complex visual stimuli, meaning that children with autism spectrum disorder mainly focus on details when they process visuospatial information. So a paradigm which was used to assess the global and local processing in autism has been developed by Caron and Motron and colleagues in 2006. And these authors modified the block design task of the Wechsler intelligence test, and they created complex images composed of blocks of similar or different colors, as you can see here in this slide. And in particular, when blocks of opposite colors were close to each other, they prompted a local processing, like on the left side of this slide. And by contrast, when most of the blocks were close to each other of the same color, they prompted a global processing, like on the right side of this slide. So we used this paradigm in this study, and in particular our participants were presented with the visoconsultative tasks, the same I've shown you before, and in this task we manipulated the global and local processing. So children were presented with the figure, they were asked to reproduce the figure by assembling the blocks. And we also administered a visuospatial working memory task in which the stimuli differed in the level of global and local processing. And in this task, participants were required to recall the location of the red cells. So let's see the results in the visoconstructive task, so the first one. In this task, we found that children with NLD were less accurate than the other groups. However, no differences come to light when between the other groups, I mean children with autism spectrum disorder and children with typical development. And similarly to the other groups, children in the non-verbal learning disability group were more accurate when a local processing was required. However, the NLD group performed generally worse in this task compared to the other groups. And regarding visuospatial working memory task, the non-verbal learning disability group, again, was less accurate than the others, and no differences emerged between the other two groups. And also, we didn't find differences in the local and global processing manipulation. So overall, this study revealed clear differences between children with non-verbal learning disability and children with autism spectrum disorder in visuospatial processing, when stimuli were both required and not required while using motor abilities. And to conclude this section, I'd like to share the results of another study with you. This is still unpublished. But the results of this study offer new evidence to support our hypothesis that non-verbal learning disability is a separate neurodevelopmental disorder. And this study also offers a cross-disorder comparison. And to my knowledge, is the first comparing children with non-verbal learning disability and children with developmental coordination disorder. So we decided to compare these two disorders, so non-verbal learning disability and developmental coordination disorder, because they may share some symptoms. And with the aim to shed further light on the neuropsychological profile of children with NMD. And specifically, we use the gold standard measure for diagnosing children with developmental coordination disorder, and the test battery, which is called the movement ABC, and is a measure of motor skills. In particular, this battery involved three areas, and the main one, dexterity area, which refer to fine motor control of hands and fingers needed to manipulate objects, the ball skill area, which requires body part coordination, visual tracking, and visual motor control, and finally, the static and dynamic balance area, which involve gross motor skills. So let's see the results of this battery of test. And our findings show that children with nonverbal learning disability obtained the same low score in the manual dexterity area as children with developmental coordination disorder. So they were similarly impaired in manual dexterity. I mean, children with nonverbal learning disability and children with developmental coordination disorder. In the ball skill area, children with NLD did not differ from children with typical development, and they didn't differ from those with developmental coordination disorder either. In other words, the performance was in the middle between developmental coordination disorder and typical development. And finally, in the static and dynamic balance area, children with NLD differed from children with developmental coordination disorder, but didn't differ from those with typical development. In other words, in this area, in the balance area, children with developmental coordination disorder obtained the lowest performance, while children with nonverbal learning disability and typical development were similar in terms of performance. So going further into the neuropsychological functioning of these clinical groups, we also administered perceptual task, the entangled figure task, in which participants have to find as many figures as possible in a complex image. You can see an example here in this slide. And we also administered two mental rotation tasks. I mean, an animal rotation task and a letter rotation task. And looking at the results in both the perceptual and mental rotation task, children with NLD underperformed compared to children with developmental coordination disorder. And importantly, children with developmental coordination disorder performed similarly to children with typical development. So to sum up, the study offered some evidence to differentiate between children with nonverbal learning disability from those with developmental coordination disorder. And again, these special processing skills seems to be in the main domain which distinguish between these two profiles. So trying to summarize the results taken into account in this section, there is a growing evidence showing that the neuropsychological profile of children with NLD is distinct from other neurodevelopmental disorders. And specifically, children with NLD show poor visuospatial intelligence, struggle in visuospatial tasks in which motor skills are not required, I mean visuospatial working memory tasks, perceptual tasks, and mental rotation, but they have also poor manual dexterity and visoconstructive skills, which require fine motor abilities. However, their gross motor abilities seem to be adequate. Okay, another area that has been studied in children with nonverbal learning disabilities related to their academic functioning. And historically, when Johnson and Michael both described the first children with nonverbal learning disability, they observed many academic difficulties, and they considered NLD to be a subtype of learning disabilities, together with dyslexia and dyscalculia. However, over the last few years, academic difficulties have been studied in relation to, or maybe as a consequence, of their visuospatial deficits. So there are many academic subjects in which visuospatial skills may be involved, and previous research has consistently revealed, for example, that visuospatial abilities are related to general mathematics and specific mental calculation or written calculation. And similarly, we can assume that studying geography or geometry require good visuospatial skills. And finally, many previous studies have investigated the ability to create spatial mental models from reading passages. And importantly, most of these areas have been studied in children with nonverbal learning disability. And in the next slides, I will try to summarize some of these studies. In this research published in 2010, we compared children with nonverbal learning disability and children with typical development. And we found that children with nonverbal learning disability made more errors than children with typical development in terms of column confusion. And consequently, they made calculation errors in written arithmetic tasks. So in order to better explain what I mean for column confusion, here I've summarized some typical errors made by children with NLD in written arithmetic tasks. And in the first example, here on the left of the two, there is a written calculation performed by a child at an intergrade. And as you can see, he had to add together 58 plus 34, and he was not able to put the numbers in column. So this is a column confusion. So I wrote the word per, which in Italian means times. And then he added together 8 plus 3, which makes 11, and 4, maybe plus per, I don't know, which in his mind is equal to 0. And in the other example on the right, the sum was 6 plus 52, and this child wrote 65 plus 2. And here with some imagination, you can find the correct digits, I mean 6, 5, and 2. And at the end, we asked the child how he had obtained these results. And he explained to us the procedure. So he added 6 plus 5, which makes 11, and 5 plus 2, which makes 7. So this is one of the best examples, in my view, of a visospatial error in arithmetic. In fact, this child was able to add together numbers, and in some ways, he knew how to do an addition, including the procedure of carrying over numbers. However, the visospatial representation of the numbers was completely wrong, and for this reason, maybe the child didn't reach the correct result. So, again, coming back to research studies and this further research, we tested three groups of children: an NLD group, a group of children with a comorbid dyscalculia and dyslexia, and children with typical development in specific calculation tasks. And as you can see in this slide, it's worth noting that children with the NLD and children with the comorbid dyscalculia and dyslexia were matched in their arithmetic skills, which were assessed using a standardized Italian battery. So they were very similar in arithmetic performances. But then we administered some experimental tasks, which required a forced choice procedure. And in the number dot task, which is represented here on the upper rectangle, children were asked to compare non-symbolic numbers represented by dots and Arabic numbers. By contrast, in the dot comparison task, here in the lower rectangle figure, they had to choose the numerically larger of the two non-symbolic information. And we measured reaction times in these tasks. So as you can see here in this image on the left, in our finding, no significant differences emerged among the three groups in the number dot task. But a significant difference was found in the dot comparison task. And as you can see here on this slide, children with NLD were slower, I mean, in terms of reaction time, than children with typical development, but they were not different from children with the comorbid dyscalculia and dyslexia. And we also administered arithmetic tasks, which assessed mental addition and arithmetic fact retrieval. And in both tasks, children were asked to check the results of a problem presented in the middle of the screen. And then they were asked to press one particular key if the result was correct. And also in this case, we measured the reaction time. And as you can see on the left, in the image on the left, an addition task, children with comorbid dyscalculia and dyslexia performed slower than children with typical development, while the other groups didn't differ statistically. And in the image here on the right, we found a difference in arithmetic fact retrieval. In particular, children with comorbid dyscalculia and dyslexia performed slower than either children with typical development and children with NLD. So overall, this study showed that even if children in the clinical groups were matched for mathematical skills, specific impairments were found. And in particular, children with NLD significantly struggle in a non-symbolic comparison task, And by contrast, children with the comorbid dyscalculia and dyslexia were slower performing both mental calculations and arithmetic facts than controls in these tasks. And in addition, children with comorbid dyscalculia and dyslexia were also slower retrieving arithmetic facts than children with nonverbal learning disability. And in this further study, children with NLD compared to those with typical development were presented with an intuitive geometric task devised by Dehan and collaborators in 2006. You can see some example of stimuli here in the slide. And in this task, a series of images were shown, and children had to select the figure that was different from a specific geometrical concept. For example, the concept of topology, so they have to find the odd one out figure. And in this research, we also administered a series of simple and complex visospatial working memory tasks. So let's see the results very briefly. Children with nonverbal learning disability performed significantly poorer than children with typical development in the intuitive geometry task. And interestingly, after controlling for complex visual stunt tasks, the difference in the intuitive geometry task was no longer significant. So again, our results confirmed that visuospatial working memory difficulty may be primary in children with NLD. And this study also offers some evidence for the assumption that visospatial working memory is critical for some aspects of mathematical cognition. So let's talk about geography. My finding, and as I mentioned before at the beginning of this section, children with nonverbal learning disability may also be impaired in geography and spatial orientation skills. Specifically, they encounter difficulties in map reading, in recalling routes, and in understanding spatial information. So at the beginning of the session, I mentioned that many studies have demonstrated that spatial mental models are spontaneously constructed as a result of reading descriptions of spatial environments. And here in this slide, two different types of spatial mental models are summarized. The spatial mental models can be constructed during reading comprehension. And these are route and survey perspectives. And in route perspective, the route description task takes the point of view of a person moving within the environment. So route the description are characterized by the use of egocentric terms such as right and left, for example, and the order in which landmarks appear during the route is important. And by contrast, survey descriptions provide an overview of the spatial layout, sometimes with the hierarchical organization, and they are characterized by the use of common terms such as the compass directions, north, south, and so on. So in a research study published in 2009, we aimed firstly to determine whether children with nonverbal learning disability had problems in their comprehension of spatial description in survey and route perspective. And as a second aim, we want to evaluate whether children with nonverbal learning disability were able to mentally construct models of spatial descriptions. So in other words, at the end of the description, they had to locate landmarks of the environment that were given in the description. So in this study, we tested children with NLD, children with dyslexia, and children with typical development. And children were presented with two spatial and one non-spatial descriptions. The spatial descriptions illustrated outdoor environments, for example, a zoo and an amusement park. And each description was given in both route and survey perspective. In contrast, the non-spatial description described wine production, which is non-spatial, and an example of a route description can be, for example, now let's start our visit to the zoo, beginning on the first side, you'll find the lions on the right, and then in the corner, you'll find the monkey's cage, and so on. So the task was to listen the description, which was read aloud by the experimenter, and then participants were required to perform a verification task, I mean a reading comprehension task with the multiple choice questions, and then a location task in which children had to locate the landmarks introduced in the spatial description. And you can see an example of a location task here in this slide. So let's see the results of the study regarding the verification task, the reading comprehension task. The results show that the group's correct responses differed in the survey condition only. So in particular, children with nonverbal learning disability performed worse than either children with dyslexia and children with typical development. And finally, the groups showed no differences in either the route or non-spatial verification task. Regarding the location task, groups were statistically different in both route and survey perspective descriptions, and specifically children with NLD performed worse than the other groups. So the results of the study overall show that children with nonverbal learning disability, even if they are competent with the verbal materials, as also demonstrated by the results and the verification task from the non-spatial description, so children with nonverbal learning disability were poor at processing spatial descriptions, and particularly poor at locating landmarks in both route and survey descriptions. Okay, and now let's talk about the social functioning of children with nonverbal learning disability. And in this field, several studies have been carried out in order to better understand the differences between children with nonverbal learning disability and children with autism spectrum disorder. And as you probably know, children with autism spectrum disorder are mainly characterized by poor social relational abilities. And some authors have suggested some similarities between children with NLD and children with autism spectrum disorder, in particular children with high functioning autism, regarding nonverbal communication. And however, research findings have shown that poor social relational skills are not only consistent in children with nonverbal learning disability, and consequently, social difficulties do not seem to be the main challenge of nonverbal learning disability. So, in this study carried out by Bloom and colleagues in 2010, they compared children with NLD, children with general learning disabilities, in their recognition and interpretation of facial expressions commonly associated with different emotions. And contrary to their hypothesis, the research findings show that children with general learning disabilities recognized and interpreted facial expressions less accurately than both children with NLD and children with typical development. And in this further research published in 2017, we compared children with nonverbal learning disability, children with dyslexia, and children with typical development in the pragmatics of language. And the pragmatics of language can be defined as the ability to use language properly in social situations and in interaction with other people. And we used a test battery to assess the pragmatics of language. And this battery involved both visual and verbal materials. And the tasks we used required understanding of metaphors, for example, implicit meaning and contextual information. And here in this slide are represented some examples of the tests we used in this study. Let's see the results of this study, and our findings reveal that the group with dyslexia was more impaired than the other groups in the pragmatics task. However, children with nonverbal learning disability obtained poor scores only in the picture metaphor tasks, which involves visual stimuli. And therefore, our results do not provide empirical evidence for deficits in pragmatics of language or social perception skills in children with nonverbal learning disability. But again, children with NLD obtained lower scores than the other groups when visual stimuli were used. And finally, in 2014, Semrod, Klickemann and colleagues compared children with nonverbal learning disability, children with autism spectrum disorder, and children with typical development in a series of executive function measures, as well as in a social perception task. Their social perception task is called CASP, Child and Adolescent Social Perception Measure, and is composed by videos showing social interactions between two or more child actors or a child and adult. And in these videos, the intonation of the voices was audible, while the language was hidden by distortion. And two measures were collected in this task. The first one is represented by emotional cues, and by this we mean the ability of the child to identify emotions And the second measure is represented by nonverbal cues, which is the ability of the child to identify gestures and nonverbal expressions of emotions. And as you can see here in this slide, the results did not show difficulties in children with NLD in identifying emotions, so the emotional cues, while children with NLD encountered difficulties in understanding nonverbal cues. So, as I previously mentioned at the beginning of this section, research findings are not always consistent in revealing poor social relational skills in children with NLD. And such difficulties could therefore be seen as a possible associated symptoms of this profile. So now to complete the overview of the studies on NLD, I will show you briefly some recent findings derived from neuroimaging studies, which have tried to identify neurobiological evidence in children with nonverbal learning disability. In this study, Jordan Fine and co-authors in 2014 found that children with NLD have a significantly smaller splenia of the corpus callosum compared to children with ADHD, children with autism spectrum disorder, and children with typical development. And the splenium of the corpus callosum is this part of the corpus callosum. And as you probably know, the corpus callosum is composed of fibers that connect the two hemispheres of the brain. And in these two other studies, further evidence was collected. In the first one, carried out by Semrud Krickman and colleagues, evidence was found suggesting that children with nonverbal learning disability and children with autism spectrum disorder showed different regional volumetric differences in the brain. And in addition, Margulis and colleagues in 2019 revealed that social difficulties in children with nonverbal learning disability and autism spectrum disorder may derive from distinct alterations in connectivity within the salience network. And they concluded that such findings represent the first step towards identifying possible neurobiological markers of nonverbal learning disability. And finally, Bunker and co-authors in 2020 compared the resting state functional connectivity of a spatial brain network among children with NLD, children with dyslexia, and children with typical development, and they found that within the spatial network, associations in some areas of the brain were reduced in children with NLD. So I'm not going to describe the details of the results of this study today. However, the authors concluded that identifying such neurobiological substrate of NLD provides evidence that this is a distinct clinical entity. So as I've shown during this presentation, a growing number of cross-disorder comparison studies are collecting evidence for neuropsychological and neurobiological distinctions between children with nonverbal learning disability and children with other neurodevelopmental disorders. And since 2017, the Nonverbal Learning Disability Project and the Division of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry at Columbia University of New York have invited me to join a group of NLD experts coming from the US and from Europe. And the aim of this group is to find a consensus definition of nonverbal learning disability and to have this diagnosis included in the DSM-5. So before considering the criteria set, we discussed changing the name to developmental visuospatial disorder instead of nonverbal learning disability. And this change was required because visuospatial processing difficulty is what differentiates nonverbal learning disability from other neurodevelopmental disorders. And another reason to change the name was to abandon both the terms nonverbal and the term learning disability, which are respectively a confusing label and a misleading diagnostic category. And recently, Fisher from Columbia University, who is leading the group of NLD experts, published a systematic review, as you can see here still in press, so it's pretty new. And Fisher and colleagues concluded that there is now sufficient evidence that children with nonverbal learning disability can be clearly differentiated from those with other neurodevelopmental disorders, and also from children with typical development, of course. So in this review, the authors also suggested that nonverbal learning disability is clearly defined by significant deficits in visuospatial abilities, and they also suggested that standard set of criteria for diagnosing children with this disorder would greatly improve research studies, as well as the possibility of helping to include this disorder in the DSM. And finally, in these two commentaries that I've been invited to write, I've summarized why research studies, as well as children and families, could benefit from having clear criteria for the diagnosis of nonverbal disability. And here I like to mention only 2 points, which are discussed more in depth in these 2 commentaries. And first of all, shared criteria should definitely help to advance research in this field. And it's important to know, as I mentioned at the beginning of my presentation, during the informal meeting, that longitudinal studies are completely missing in this area. And probably one of the reasons is that there is an absence of shared criteria. And in addition, new potential selection criteria could also help to carry out studies into comorbidities with other disorders. I want to remind you that until now, research on this topic has been engaged in ways to distinguish the nonverbal learning disability from other neurodevelopmental disorders. But we are all probably aware that neurodevelopmental disorders often co-occur together, and studies on comorbidity might be important to better understand comorbid profiles as well as neurodevelopmental disorders in general. And the second point I'd like to mention here is that shared criteria could ensure that children with nonverbal learning disability are correctly identified and do not receive a misdiagnosis of other disorders. A misdiagnosis may be unhelpful and can have negative consequences, creating confusion for families, teachers, and children. And in addition, a recognized diagnostic category is also important for choosing the most appropriate intervention, because an incorrect diagnosis prompts intervention which are usually employed for other disorders and could be unhelpful for these children. So in conclusion, as I have tried to summarize in this presentation, thanks to the efforts of the most recent studies in this field, the visuospatial disorder will hopefully be recognized in the international diagnostic manuals such as the DSM over the next few years. So now I've finished my presentation. I hope that my presentation has stimulated your curiosity about children with visuospatial difficulties, and I'd like to thank you very much for your listening. Okay, I'm finished.
Thank you very much. What a great talk, very comprehensive as well. So if you have questions, then would you please type them into the chat? That was the request of Irene, to be sure that you won't miss anything.
Yeah, it was a very long presentation.
That's exactly in the normal time frame. So just waiting for the questions which you could put into the chat. You can of course log on and accompany your question in the chat. It's your live expression as well.
There is a question.
Great question.
Okay.
if not being in the soul, sorry.
Yeah, the nonverbal learning disability is almost unknown. As a disorder, as I mentioned at the beginning of this presentation. In the clinical practice, practitioner usually seen children with this type of problems. And into schools, it's more difficult to that teachers are able to see these children, because and that's the reason, maybe because this disorder was confused in the past with the other learning disabilities, because children with the nonverbal learning disability also have many problems in academic achievement. As I showed in the presentation, they can have difficulties in mathematics, in reading comprehension, when reading comprehension requires to create spatial mental models of the environments. They can have problems in geometry, and also they can have problems in handwriting because of the fine motor skills which are impaired. Teachers can see all these aspects, but of course they are not able to diagnose this type of disorder.
I also typed a couple of them.
Yeah. With motion vision.
Like, so added papers reviewed here use the same definition, or were there various definitions of NLD used?
Okay, I start with the question of Kate Liang. Sorry if I don't.
Oh, I haven't noticed yet. Sorry. My mistake. Yes.
It's fine. Okay.
It came at the same time, probably.
Yes, I think so. And if there are problems in their vision, there are no studies on this topic. We performed a study, but we didn't publish the results, in which we found problems in stereopsis, which is the ability of the brain to put together the images of the two eyes. And some findings, but are not published. Show that children with nonverbal learning disability can have problems in stereopsis. The other question is by Dennis, I think, psychology department.
Oh yeah, everybody asks.
Okay. As the papers are reviewed here, use the common definition of nonverbal learning disability. Not at all, that's the problem of this topic, because missing clear criteria and shared criteria also produce research with different criteria. So no, the studies I reviewed here in this presentation used different criteria. Mm-hmm. And the consensus definition points, we in the consensus arrived to a definition of this disorder, and it was sent to the panel of the DSM, and we are waiting for the review and to see if there are.
So you haven't managed to reach a consensus yet?
Yeah, we reached the consensus.
Oh,
yes, and we sent the definition criteria to the panel of the DSM. We are waiting for the response.
I see.
Is there one profile or many? Third question of Dennis. One profile of many. I think there is one profile of children with developmental visuospatial disorder, but as in most of the neurodevelopmental disorders, there are many comorbidities. So if you look at the main profile, you can find that they have problems in visuospatial abilities. But if you look at the other domains, cognitive and emotional domains, you can find many comorbidities. But I think as in most of the neurodevelopmental disorders. And the last question, Usha. Yes, developmental indications.
So if you had a baby, what would you be looking for? What would start worrying you?
Yeah, when they are babies, it depends on the age. I think you can see some motor problems, in particular fine motor problems with their hands. And usually in the history of these children, there are problems in families tell us that these children don't like to draw or to play with the puzzles or with blocks, constructions. So these can be the indicators when they are very young. They are in development, I think. So fine motor problems and problems in drawing, for example, during do you say, before of entering into schools, these children don't like to make the usual activities that are involved during kindergarten, for example, drawing, using, I don't know the name.
Cutting out, things like that.
Exactly. Yeah. And these kind of abilities are very problematic for these children.
Okay, very interesting.
Right, any other questions perhaps? And we'll be excited to see the change to DSM. All right, and if there are no any other questions, I thank you for the talk again. Right, and this is the point where we would go for drinks, but we can attempt to have virtual drinks even without a Zoom connection. That may be said. So thank you very much again for your talk.
Thank you.
And then thank you for the audience for being here.
Yes.
Even the ones who left already. And goodbye.
Bye, Dennis. Thank you very much again for your listening. Thank you. Bye.